Hi, my name's Amanda Allen. I work with the Director of Marketing here at PARC. And I just wanted to welcome everyone tonight and introduce our fantastic forum speakers. It's my pleasure to announce them, retired Colonel Peter Newell, who served in the U.S. Army for over 32 years, lastly as the Director of the U.S. Army Rapid Equipping Forces, and is currently a visiting Senior Research Fellow at the Center for Technology and National Security at National Defense University. Dr. Joseph Felter, who retired from the U.S. Army as a colonel following a career as a Special Forces and Foreign Affairs Officer with distinguished service in a variety of special operations and diplomatic assignments. He held leadership positions in the U.S. Army Rangers and Special Forces and directed the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point from 2005 to 2008. He is co-director of the Empirical Studies of Conflict Project and a research fellow at the Hoover Institution. And last but certainly not least, Professor Tom Byers, who's been at Stanford University since 1995. At Stanford, he focuses on education regarding high growth entrepreneurship and technology innovation. He is the first holder of the Entrepreneurship Professorship and Endowed Chair in the School of Engineering, and is also a Bass University Fellow in Undergraduate Education. He is a past recipient of the prestigious Gordon Prize by the National Academic Engineering Academy of Engineering in the USA and Stanford University's Gores Award, which is its highest honor for its excellence in teaching. Thank you so much for coming. Enjoy, everyone.
PARC for having us, and to all of you for coming out this afternoon to be here in the live audience. Can we turn down my mic just a little bit? Otherwise, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt somebody's ears, including mine. Wow, I am pretty excited. I am pretty jacked up to be here. I mean, it doesn't. If you have a pulse and if you love technology, you know where we are right now. I mean, we are in one of the most important places in the field. And so driving over, struck me just how important Xerox PARC has been. And this seminar series, I had to look it up, but it has been going on for about 40 years because I've been coming to it for about 30 of those. Even during the days when I was lucky enough to be at Symantec Corporation during its beginning. But 20 years ago, as you heard, I made a left turn or right turn on Page Mill and turned the other way to Stanford University and got involved in this notion of teaching innovation and entrepreneurship. So when Xerox got in touch with me to give a seminar here, I was trying to think, what could we say that was new? And this is what came to mind right away. And so the next 45 minutes, we're going to have a little chat, and then we'll open up to Q&A in the usual format and template of the seminar. So innovation and entrepreneurship, it is a very popular topic. Everybody is talking about it. I mean, it's a bipartisan topic. Democrats love it. Republicans love it here in the United States. World leaders love it, whether they're, even China loves it. It's an extraordinary situation what's happened. Innovation, entrepreneurship is like this glue, this middle ground that you hear over and over. So what are we going to make of this? So first of all, it has almost lost its meaning, both words. It's been used. I mean, the good news is everybody's, likes it. Is enamored with it as a discipline or a field or a topic, but also it's tended to lose its meaning. So, maybe for the purposes of the day, we look at innovation as creating something new. Maybe it's a technology or maybe it's a process, like a business process, like a business model or something. And let's look at entrepreneurship as the way of launching or, establishing some way for that to get into society, like maybe starting an enterprise, maybe starting a program, just putting it into action. Let's just use that as a sort of quick and dirty definition for entrepreneurship. So why did I say I was so excited? Well, the last 20 or 40 years has been extraordinary. I look in the room and I notice a few of you went to college like I did, which was in the last century. Okay? For those of you who were in college before the turn of the century, I have to ask you to suspend your memory of the opportunities and offerings regarding innovation and entrepreneurship on your campus at that day. I mean, of course you do that when you think about the technologies. I mean, if you think of the technologies in those days, I mean, I was trained at Berkeley, computer languages that the rest of you, the ones in your room who graduated after the year 2000, don't even know the names of. I have to ask you, when it comes to this field, you'll be surprised at what's happened. It's extraordinary. I mean, for example, at Stanford, we have 150 to 160 different titles, different courses taught to every and available to every single student on the campus. So, you might remember, we had entrepreneurship courses or innovation courses, but they were, for second year MBA students. No, no longer. The entire population at Stanford has access to that. But the other day, I had the honor of going to an offsite with the president of the University of California, an old colleague of y'all's, Janet Napolitano, and all the chancellors of the UC systems. And that day and a half offsite, was about, guess what, innovation and entrepreneurship at the University of California. And if I added up across the 10 campuses, I would say they'd have 1,000 courses being offered right now in this topic. And that's for credit. Not much. That's not counting the competitions and the other sorts of ways for students nowadays, no matter what their field is. And of course, business is obvious, engineering and science is obvious, but even arts, humanities, and social science majors are having a chance to learn about this. You might also think that it's about writing business plans. Really? There's 1,000 courses in the UC system and more than 150 at Stanford. Business plan writing classes? What a waste of time. Very few are about the traditional process of writing a plan. It comes up in a lot of other different ways. So that is, it's a wide portfolio of subject matter around it, and we're going to dive into one of those today. You might say the motivation is about making money. And that's just not true. Maybe there's a couple of kids who are thinking they want to be a founder to get rich quick. They find out very quickly that is not the case. I mean, statistically, that's not the case. And so that's two standard deviations to the right. It's really about making things happen, changing the world, as we'll demonstrate today. I wanted to check. Oh, you might think it's about tech transfer. You might think, it only has to do with tech transfer. But as I said it before, yes, that's a little bit of it, about accelerating inventions out of the lab and into the marketplace. But it is really about reaching every student and having them learn about what it means to have an entrepreneurial mindset or have a design thinking sort of mentality. And everybody can learn it. It's not something you're born with. That myth we break right away. So that's exciting. So the other thing I want to mention before we get into this is a couple of things happen along the way besides the explosion of courses. The methods and the tools to learn this were developed. I mean, in other words, terrific scholars went after it and developed things like design thinking. David Kelly and that whole crew took the work that had been doing and companies like IDEO took that, put it around a pedagogy, around a curriculum that could be learned by anyone. And then in the center that I've had the pleasure of operating the last 20 years called STVP, we've introduced a number of methods and learning tools, including one that brings us here today. And really, we're missing the one more person here. He's in New Zealand. That's Steve Blank, who made popular a set of methods and techniques called the Lean Startup Method and made it in a way that was digestible, approachable, and teachable. to all students. So with that, I thought, okay, I'm done. I mean, that's it. That's my message. And I thought, well, wait a minute, I got to find another 30, 45 minutes to you know, capture your attention and imagination. And I want to tell you a story about one particular, the most exciting thing I've seen in the field over the last year. And that has to do with applying these techniques to big, hairy challenges. And there's probably, yeah, there's a lot, you know, that we, you know, who did go to school in the last century, we're leaving behind for the young folks, the next generation, a number of things that need to be addressed. And technology will play a role, but we're also going to need some innovation and processes. So there's probably no bigger one. And how appropriate today, while the Secretary of Defense designee was being interviewed by the Senate, and how appropriate that we would be talking about national security and diplomacy. So that's how I got to know these two folks. Now we're going to set it up by having them introduce themselves by talking a little bit about some of the things they've seen in national security, and then we'll stitch it all together. Who's going to kick it off?
Tom said this is more of a living room style talk, so I'm going to live up to that and be hopefully a little casual. So why are we here? You know, when Pete Newell and I, soon after we were commissioned in the mid-late 80s, end of the Cold War, the United States, we were dominant. Our military was dominant. You know, we still had some near-peer competitors out there. The world wasn't easy, but we dominated the battlefield. We had better technology, our advantages were just overwhelming on the battlefield. For example, back in 1989, this is December 20th, 1989. Pete and I had just parachuted into Panama. I probably don't even remember that, just a little blip on the news feed from a long time ago. Pete was in the 82nd Airborne Division, jumped into a commercial airfield called Torrijos Tucumán, and I was with a Ranger Regiment, and we jumped into a Rio Hato airfield.
Well, I didn't jump into the airfield, but that's where I was supposed to.
Okay. Well, yeah,
we missed.
We were there. We were very close together on that dark night. There's nothing easy or comforting about going into combat and seeing, you know, tracers coming at you for the first time. This is my first combat experience. But there was a certain confidence that we had better technology than our adversaries. And this is going to be a little tongue-in-cheek, but let me just describe to you, when we jumped in, you know, we had these night vision goggles that we could see in the night. We could rule the night. I mean, pretty incredible, right? We had these things called GPS that had satellites in the sky that they could tell us where we were. I mean, this is like high speed, high tech, only superpowers have this kind of stuff, right? We had secure communications down to the soldier level. We could actually talk to people in secure ways and direct operations. We had handheld laser designator devices. I mean, this is like Star Wars. This is like super high tech advanced stuff. That we could use to direct fire, call in fires, direct fire maneuver of our soldiers. We had overhead imagery, taking pictures from satellites that could give us, it was highly classified, of course. You know, of course, we had to classify this, where we could actually do detailed mission planning. And so this is an example, if you can pick me out there, you're ahead of the game. But so we dominate. We got there, yeah, under canopy, we're vulnerable for a little bit, but as soon as we hit the ground and started leveraging our superior advantages in technology, ruled the night, ruled the week, ruled the month, picked it up, you know, got in our A and went home. You know, it's good to be on the home team. A little over a year later, you've heard of Desert Storm, 100 hours, we destroyed the fifth largest army in the world. I mean, shock and awe. I mean, I'm a little patriotic, but this is a good time to be an American, right? Good time to be an American military. I mean, we won the wars we got into. We won them decisively, we won them quickly, and without a doubt, we're the dominant military on the planet. Things changed, okay? 10, 15 years later, we were actually, all those technological advantage I just described you going into, you know, a credit card, $100, an internet connection, any terrorist, any insurgent could get all that gear, and then some. And not only could they get the technology, but they could adapt and change much faster than we could for reasons they weren't constrained by some of the systems and bureaucracies that our own military is facing. Pete lived that personally, and I'll let him kind of describe how things changed from dominance to we just may lose the next fight we're in and why.
So I managed not to go back into combat between 1991 and 2001, 9/11. But what we found generally say is that there's the person who loses the fight or the one at ringside tends to learn more than the one who wins. Well, that's what happened to us between 1990 and 2010. Lots of people were watching Just Cause Desert Storm. Technology starts to move, it starts to democratize, it proliferates, and pretty soon everybody's got it. You're going to flash forward to 2010. In 2010, I had commanded a battalion in Iraq in the early days of the Iraq War, and I had just left Iraq as a brigade commander, a brigade, 5,000 people. I had occupied the space that essentially covers all of southern Iraq except for the city of Basra. And that includes a couple hundred miles of the Iranian border, the swamps, three major cities, 180,000 Iraqi security forces. And I was given a job of an organization called the Army's Rapid Equipment Force. And if you've heard of it, if you haven't, it's essentially what you would get if you take a Skunk Works and give it its own venture capital fund. A $200 million budget, 160 people, and my job was to go around the battlefield and find problems, find commercial technologies, modify them, not modify them, do whatever, but very quickly get inside the acquisition system and solve the point problem while educating the rest of the system on what was wrong. In 2010, I showed up in Afghanistan because I hadn't been in Afghanistan a long time and I knew it was different. And if you remember history at all, this is right at the point where people have acknowledged that we are losing the war in Afghanistan. God forbid the United States lose a war, but we were losing in Afghanistan. And the president had decided to commit another 100,000 troops and folks in a surge. And what he elected to commit were all dismounted light infantrymen. There are no tanks, no Bradleys. It's folks dressed like us with a little bit of body armor go into the country. Unfortunately, if you were sitting in the Pentagon, you had been fighting the Iraq War for 7 years by now, 6 years, and you're running $1.5 billion program to deliver these really cool V-shaped hull, mine-resistant, armored-protected vehicles called MRAPs. $1.5 billion program, and we're like 60% through it. So if you're sitting in the Pentagon, this is what the country of Afghanistan looks like to you. If you're sitting in Afghanistan, that's what it looks like. When the surge started, the first brigade-sized organization like mine that I'd had came out of Fort Campbell, Kentucky. In 30 days from the day that they landed in Afghanistan, they thought they were going to Iraq. So they had the wrong people, the wrong training, the wrong equipment, and they were suddenly plopped inside the city of Kandahar, which was a hornet's nest. The Taliban, despite the fact that lots of people can't read in Afghanistan, they're not stupid. And actually, they're pretty prolific at understanding and watching things very patiently and coming up with very fast solutions to those things that get in their way. They saw this one coming. Those guys showed up, and instead of attacking these things with improvised explosive devices, they realized it was much cheaper and safer to go after these guys, and they did. Let me show you a chart that the gray lines behind me, starting in about 2009, reflect the number of improvised explosive attacks against dismounted, not armored forces in Afghanistan. As you go across, you can start to see where the spikes are. The first one in June of 2009 is about the time that the Marines went into Helmand Valley. And that was the first time we'd really gone into a place like that. It's a lot of rice paddy, a lot of dikes, that you just can't move around in it. And you could see where they went from zero to folks are starting to try new techniques out of it and doing things. By the time I showed up in October of 2010, we're sitting at 900. 900 of these attacks have taken place. But I'll walk you through what we learned in the process, and it's a little startling of how quickly this battle changed and how ill-equipped our system was to respond to what we were seeing. There we go. So we learned that the Taliban had their own problem-solving cycle. And we always used to think that, you know, you saw a spike, and it started to dip. You thought, okay, we're winning. We figured out what they're doing, and we're knocking it down. Well, we were wrong. What was really going on is they had started a technique. We're using doorbells, or I'm using pressure plates, or I'm using RF power to set off an IED. We'd figure that out. They'd back off a little bit, rearm, having watched us for a little bit, say, well, we're going to do this a different way. And they would come out swinging. And the next spike would be even higher. As you can see how many times this repeated, went from 20 incidences to 470 to 900 in a short period of time. There's our learning cycle. It took us 6 months to realize that we had a problem. In another 6 months, which is light speed by military acquisition standards, it's light speed by anybody's standards. 6 months to figure out we had a problem, and 6 months to start to field things that would actually solve that problem. Unfortunately, that's the way the world works today. I don't care if it's IEDs or communications or you name it. The democratization of technology, the ease of access, the ability to manufacture fairly complicated things has been reduced to a level where just about anybody can do it. And we've reached the point, rather than being dominant on the battlefield with the only guys who could afford the really high-speed stuff, that we can achieve dominance, but it's a really temporal thing. It doesn't last long. And invariably, somebody watches what we do and says, well, I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to do it this way. And are finding a way to pick and choose the time and place where they're going to hurt us very badly. The problem kills people. That 6 month cost us 4,800 some odd young men and women who lost their lives, limbs, eyesight, suffered concussions, traumatic brain injuries, or whatnot. 5,000 because we were slow to recognize a change in the world. 5,000 because we were slow to deliver the solutions to it. The world's changed radically for us. And we, unfortunately, folks like Joe and I, came out of service with the mentality that we had to take some responsibility for changing the way technologists and people in the military mixed and fought to knock down those problems. So that's essentially our motivation for being here. I would say what we learned is the fact that the world has dramatically changed. And I personally, I don't see it changing anymore. I suspect that it's going to continue to get worse as technology gets faster and faster and faster as it changes. And we'll reach the point where it no longer matters how good the equipment is the day you show up for the fight. What matters is how fast you change once it starts. And right now, despite the technological and economic advantages of this country, we're slow to recognize things have changed, and we're resistant to taking on those changes and speeding how we get them out there. I'm not attacking the acquisition system, though. I'm attacking the fact that we fail to recognize something changed, and we have no mechanism for taking those changes and those problems and delivering them back into PARC, where lots of really bright people know how to fix them.
So enter innovation and entrepreneurship. What could that do for you?
There we go.
Or us, because this is all our collective situation.
Yeah.
Yeah, talk about this a little bit.
All right, so it's interesting. Joe and I met while I was in the middle of the last job, and I have come to Stanford, I was solving an underground problem. In Afghanistan, the aquifer is all underground. They call it the Khrez system, but it's really all the water moves underground through a series of caves. Lots of other stuff moves underground through caves too. Fertilizer, ignition systems, weapons, people, money. They figured out how to use that same aquifer to move things. If you look at overhead imagery of Afghanistan, it looks like somebody went on a perfect line of a bombing run. You see all these divots in the ground? Those aren't bombs. It's where people have dug their wells to get to the aquifer. And every one of those wells provides an opportunity to hide something. And there are thousands, some of them at 8,000 feet, some at 12,000 feet, some at 2,000 feet. Sometimes the well has access that goes underneath the landing strip at Bagram Airfield, much to our chagrin. So we had to figure out how to get into these things and look what was inside of them. And of course, when we went to go do that, we did it exactly the same way we did it in Vietnam. Some young man with a pistol on a rope lowered into this thing who was supposed to go find stuff. Deaf, dumb, blind, and really unafraid of what he's going to run into. Well, you can do that a couple times. You might even do it 50 times before you set a pattern. I need to realize there are thousands of these things. So you may check 10, go to the next 10. You know, somebody's just putting more stuff in the other 10. So I was here looking for a robotic system that we could actually get into the caves and go look at it. Mining industry use them, fiber optic cable, which is interesting until you realize you need 400 pounds of cable and a 3-kilowatt generator to run it, and you have to lug that up a mountain to use it. It just doesn't work. I'd come out to Stanford to talk to a mechanical engineering professor who I thought had a potential solution. Met Joe, who had just come out of Afghanistan. Didn't find what I wanted, but in my conversation with Joe, we started talking about the problems I was having. And Joe, after we got lost on campus, we hopped in a car and we essentially went on a pub crawl of some of the startups in Palo Alto. And as an Army colonel, I was sitting down in a garage with a bunch of people coding things, and I'd get to talk about the problems I had, and I'd get really great contextual answers back from these guys. It was really exciting. So I spent more time coming out here. I spent time with the D school. I spent a lot of time with Joe. It got to the point that I was able to send a one-page assessment of a problem that I was trying to solve to Joe, and Joe would rewrite that in something that made sense to people out here. I'd show up a month later in an auditorium like this, and instead, in Washington, D.C., if I did that, I'd have 2,000 people in the room, and the two guys that I needed to talk to would be in the back of the room someplace, and I'd never get to them. When I came here, it'd be 40, and there'd be 20 people I needed to talk to in the room. And it increased the speed at which I could get at things. So the entrepreneurial spirit of cutting into that.
So how did you make the connection then to creating a class around this, solving these
problems? Yeah, great. We can. I think we got that slide coming up. Yeah. So Pete and I shared a common interest in, you know, we need to do better. We're losing. And we're not doing well with the status quo. And we did an effort to the Defense Department's credit. They recognize this. There are some visionary, introspective leaders within the DoD said, hey, we need to do better. How can we get better at being innovative? And where do you look? I mean, friendly crowd here, you look to this area, to Silicon Valley. And they asked Pete, who had a lot of contacts from having just left the organization, hey, why don't you do this maybe intense problem-solving exercise, and even better if you can do it at Stanford. You know, Stanford's got a good cachet. So Pete and I hosted a week-long exercise over spring break, and we managed to get some of the active duty military officers and veterans students who were students at Stanford. A couple of them here. William, you want to raise your hand out there? I think we got one. What else can you do on spring break except solve some DoD problems? We got together and we called it Hacking Defense. And then Bill Perry's longtime chief of staff, Deborah Gordon, said, no. Hacking for defense. The Chinese are hacking defense. The Russians are hacking defense. So good call. So we got to give her credit for that. So we call her Hacking for Defense. And, you know, we used design thinking, a variety of different approaches. Did okay. Outbriefed former Secretary of Defense Bill Perry at the end. very impressed with the product. He so impressed, he said, you know what? If you can do this over spring break with a handful of students, why don't you teach a class? And so Pete and I go, be careful what you ask for, right? So how do we teach this class? And we struggled to think how this class might look, because we didn't really, to teach a class over a core, you need a good, solid methodology that's developed, a plan. It's one thing to do 5 days intensive exercise. It's another thing to teach a class full of Stanford students or, you know, some of the brightest people anywhere. Just, you know, just ask them. That was a dig on you, Constantine? No, he was in the class with us. But the planets align, serendipity, fate, what have you. One of the military, former military students that helped us with that hacking for defense, a week-long exercise, was taking Steve Blank's famous lean launch pad class. Are you familiar with Steve Blank and the lean launch pad, a lean methodology? You know, it's one of those just widely oversubscribed course on campus. It's, you know, five times as many students apply to it than there's space. And the incentives to take this class are clear. You join this, you get in this class, you build a company, and you get rich. Clear incentives, right?
Well, you learn something along the way.
But this former Special Forces operator brought Steve Blank down to see Pete, and I was in the meeting. And it was going to be a 20-minute, you know, meet and greet, get to know each other. 3 hours later, the mutual epiphany was that what Pete was doing in Afghanistan and his very cutting-edge organization that he really upped the game with this rapid equipping force.
After drawing both sides of a dry erase board down the wall, Steve and I realized that what he had been teaching since 1999 is what I had built the organization to do. I don't have an MBA. I'd never heard of him. Didn't know any of the terms. But the scribbling on the wall was identical.
Yeah. And we finally had the methodology. Are you familiar with the lean methodology, business model canvas? Now, it's pretty clear. Let's just talk about that. So we had a methodology, but it wasn't a perfect fit. But we had hope that we could put a class together. And Steve Blank, to his enormous credit, I mean, this guy, you know, he doesn't have to do anything, let's just say, that he doesn't want to do. But he was so interested after that meeting that he said, hey, I'm in. You can use my methodology.
And he helped retool it.
And we had to retool it.
For example, you don't really have customers. You have
exactly.
What you call them.
So if you're, who's familiar with the business model canvas? How do you measure success for trying to start a company? What do you measure it?
Revenue,
profit. Mm-hmm. Does the military measure their success? I mean, so we had to come up with a new measure of success. We call it like mission achievement, right? That's succeeding. And are you familiar with the term customer discovery? Yeah, customers, is that really the right word for the people in the military?
Young men and women doing things aren't customers. In fact, they don't even buy things. Yeah. They take whatever's good.
So we call them beneficiaries. And importantly, the beneficiaries aren't the ones buying the solution. So there were some important differences, but got together and made some modifications to the business model canvas, called it the mission model canvas. And that became the kind of the core framework that we used to teach this class. And everything else about the class very much mirrored the Lean Launchpad class that Steve had made so popular at Stanford and Cal and a few other schools.
Which is essentially the scientific method for business. Get out, talk to people, iterate. So we'll come back to that.
The one other significant difference is that Lean Launchpad and entrepreneurial classes are generally based around teams who come together with an idea for something they want to build.
Right.
We don't do it that way. And what I said about problems, we insisted on starting with a problem that was sponsored by a government organization. So we recruited government agencies to give us their nasty, stinking problems, and then had teams, let's just say, had the government compete to get teams of Stanford students to take their problem to compete to get into the class.
It was sort of a flipped model to the typical entrepreneurship class that's focused on launching, you know, ideas that students have, like let's make, you know, an app that's going to deliver food. I mean, that would be, you know, that'd be something, or, you know, another photo app, something like that. This is a completely flipped situation where the problems were coming. So let's talk about hacking for defense.
With some adult supervision from Tom, fortunately, we were able to get the course. And anyone have experience working on universities? Maybe Stanford is kind of resistant to change, new things. Even Stanford, as you know, which is probably better than most. But Tom gave us a huge power assist. We got the course listed. Put a lot of time developing the course. Pete and to some degree me and others tapped our networks to bring problems in. But at the end of the day, we didn't know if students were going to show up. Again, what student's going to show up and spend 20 hours a week to work on someone else's problem? And we were concerned, but maybe it's partially a self-selection process, but we had some amazing students.
Well, this is a cool picture. Who's in the picture, just to tell you, who would, because was there 60 students, or yeah, who were all those people?
It was funny. We taught the class in a room that held 90-some-odd people. Only 32 people made it into the class.
Students.
Eight teams of four was all we could take. The rest of that room, I think I'll answer what I said, but the rest of that room are advisors to the teams or teaching staff or other interested people. We open the doors to come in. You're interested in what we're doing, come have a seat. We fill the room every week with people from the community who are interested, who wanted to help these students. The teams are treated like a startup. The board of directors is the teaching team, Tom Byers, Steve Blank, Joe Felter, Pete Newell. The problem sponsor from the agency sponsoring the problem. You know, the class was almost as hard for them as it was for the students because they had to be there all the time participating. And then we brought advisors from places like PARC or Booz Allen or SAIC or other folks who advised the teams on the technology. So they really looked like a baby startup and were treated like a startup. And if your startup showed them a class and was screwed up and they were trying to brief the board on something, anybody ever sat in front of a board with a bad idea and walked out unscathed?
Steve Blank has a term he calls relentlessly direct feedback, and it lives up to it.
That was one of the few times I saw you guys smiling
in this
class.
In this room, myself, Steve, Joe, the gentleman sitting back is a former ambassador.
Yeah, for counterterrorism, and he was the JSOC commander.
Across the back row are a number of SOCOM reps. There's Tom in the front. This, the gentleman sitting between my arms, was the Army's asymmetric warfare group.
Yeah.
And then the students down on those front two rows.
And the students come from all majors. Yeah. And there was business students. There was engineering students. Humanities majors, as I mentioned earlier, as well as, even though the course was advertised for graduate students, I particularly remember the two young women who were sophomores in computer science who did an amazing job for NSA.
That's good, because that's the tape on.
Oh, is that the tape?
So I'll show you.
So let's
at the end of this course.
Just a really quick question. Yeah. Your spring break group is called Acting for Defense.
Yes.
It's the same title of the first course.
Yeah,
we're not real bright, so we just took the same name and ran with it again.
Yeah, my department chair loved the name. I'm kidding.
It's the name.
But then we added Steve Blank's methodology, Tom's adult supervision, and
Hacking for Defense.
2.0.
I'm going to get up and show you a two-minute clip. At the end of the course, the students don't do a pitch on their solution. They do a pitch on their journey of where they went. It was interesting, what we've learned, I don't know how many problems have come through the system, is that no problem that has ever been nominated by a government sponsor has ever survived the course in its original form. What we realized is the government is especially good at perfectly solving the wrong problem.
I want you to share the tape, but spark out some of the, we keep saying Defense Department, Intelligence Agency, specific groups.
Understand
the breadth of this.
The first iteration, we looked at DOD organizations as well as intelligence community organizations. And, importantly, this, we couldn't believe it, but the NSA even sponsored a problem, and we're okay being acknowledged having sponsored that. But Special Operations Command, we had some. Are there any SEALs in the audience? I think I see one back there.
SEALs did one or two.
You know what SEALs stand for, right? What does SEAL stand for? Okay, we got a quiet SEAL. That's very unusual to be a non-quiet SEAL.
And
sleep, eat, and lift, but I didn't say that. I'm a special force guy.
Here.
So Navy Special Warfare, and I'll stop when the video plays. We had, again, as Pete said, our asymmetric warfare group. We had the Joint Enterprise Threat Defeat Agency.
Pacific Command
in
the Navy, the ships.
And we had a lot more sponsors interested in getting the problem solved than we had students. So, and Pete mentioned this, you actually have to compete as a sponsor to have the privilege of having your tough problem looked at by a Stanford team.
So after 10 weeks and the groups going through this method, you're going to see now a short presentation by that.
Yeah. This one of eight.
By the groups.
Randomly selected.
A couple of minutes long just to get a feel for their progress. Any luck on that yet?
social engineering have multiplied. Hackers are constantly adapting, using the latest and most popular platforms to achieve their ends. Adversaries use sites like Twitter not just to reach recruits, but also to fish for sensitive information by tricking other users. Furthermore, state actors use fake accounts on social media to spread misinformation. A New York Times article from May 30th, 2016, quotes Finnish journalist Jessica Aro on Russian trolls. There are so many layers of fakery, you get lost. As part of Stanford University's Hacking for Defense class, four students, Gabby Fisher, Chris Gomes, Maya Israni, and Travis Knoll, are working with the National Security Agency to apply the lean methodology of customer discovery and help solve this problem. FishReel's current MVP helps move the needle on entity enrichment. Users enter a Twitter handle and receive basic information about that account. The user receives an analysis of the most predictive heuristics used for identifying anomalous accounts. The Show More Data button allows users to compare the results of this user against 60,000 other randomly sampled Twitter users. At this point in time, heuristics include follower and followee analyses, account age, level of customization, and several others. FishReel also currently integrates with the People API to return a sorted list of other potentially associated social media accounts. Armed with this information, users can better understand just who or what is behind a social media handle that may be undertaking social engineering. The next step for FishReel is getting feedback on this prototype while testing use cases for government and non-government entities.
So, Joe, what happened next?
So, no good deeds go unpunished. And it was a very successful course, thanks to a lot of hard work from, you know, from the teaching team down to, shout out to Constantine, shout out to one of our superstar TAs back there, Constantine, if there are some others, and we had a lot of other folks helping. But it was a very successful course. And then going back to how we modified the business model canvas to the mission model canvas, you know, if you're measuring success not through revenue, profit, but mission achievement, well, there's a lot of other organizations, public sector organizations, government organizations, that also measure their success, not in revenue and profit, but through accomplishing a tough mission. So we thought, hey, let's expand. And we had a State Department representative here in the area that was sent out here to be the kind of the innovation officer for the State Department. Connected with him, a political science professor, Jeremy Weinstein, and the State Department rep, Zvika Krieger, and Steve Blank, of course, the secret sauce. And we decided, let's help the State Department. Let's help them with some tough problems. And we created a course called Hacking for Diplomacy. Again, very similar to Hacking for Defense, except now the customer, if you will, the sponsor organization was not the DOD and the intelligence community, but the State Department. And it was very successful. And again, it amazing students showed up, these amazing diverse teams of four student teams made some real progress, doing some really tough work, like assessing peacekeeping operation effectiveness, looking at how to coordinate aid for the Syrian refugee crisis, how to keep space objects and satellites from colliding in orbit, a range of topics. And we even had a Secretary of State come out, John Kerry. It's great to be at Stanford. Everyone shows up here. And there's one of his live tweets. And we're going to show you a quick video from one of the teams in this course to give you kind of a flavor for what they accomplished. And I'm glad Pete's running the tech. This team is trying to coordinate aid and response for the Syrian refugee crisis. Thank you. just an example of how we're expanding the aperture, if you will, of the types of organizations this methodology is helpful in the types of problems it can be applied to. Not only are we expanding the aperture as far as the organizations whose problems we look at, we're trying to take a scale. Now, Steve Blank, initially I'm thinking, hey, let's teach a good course at Stanford, and full stop. Steve Blank, big scale, big think. No, it's not good enough. We're going to take this and scale it across the country. So we're working aggressively now with some really relentlessly direct feedback from Steve to expand the Hacking for Defense program across the country to different universities. And I think Darren Halford's here. Is he out here? He's helping us take point helping as part of a nonprofit effort to help scale this along with some other folks from.
So it's interesting, folks are familiar with the National Science Foundation's I-Corps program. Well, Steve Blank is responsible for establishing the courseware for the I-Corps program. It wasn't a shocker that when folks teaching I-Corps in universities heard about this course, they raised their hands, said us too. I think we probably had a dozen requests by other universities to teach this course before we ever taught the first class. In order to meet that demand, because it skyrocketed, we took a twist on it and said, we're not just going to certify educators to teach this course. We're going to certify the government problem sponsors to be participants in it to help them write better problems. So we created an educator's course. It's not like we didn't have anything to do. We ran the first educator's course in September with, I think it was 16 universities, 9 or 10 government organizations, and probably 8 or 9 corporations sent folks who want to be mentors to students and other folks to go through this. And that one went well enough that we had 2 spin-off classes in the fall, and I had a number of universities who were yesterday launched their Hacking for Defense classes, Georgetown University last night. Next week we'll be on the East Coast teaching another educator's course. But it was interesting when you look at first round, they're all the way down to Australia. And interesting enough, we will spend the better part of February and March in Australia helping the Australian Department of Defense stand up their Hacking for Defense program. The Canadians are right behind them. The NATO is right behind them. The host of folks who want to get involved. Second course around, it was interesting, is we got more problem sponsors in the room than we got universities, is people are starting to come out of the woodwork with, hey, I want my problems in the university, and I want access to the students in what's coming out of this thing. Down at the bottom of the chart, you can't see it very well, but the corporations that are there are now funding universities to run this class.
The important Cisco, yes. Yeah, Booz Allen, Hamilton, Battelle. So this is important.
What's interesting is they saw the value proposition to them was one is they want the early read on the problems that are coming out of the government, but they also realize that those students working on the problem are actually gaining experience that the typical student doesn't get in university, and those are their future employees if they play it right. Like they really want early access to how we're going to hire these people and get them to come to work with us. Mm-hmm. So they certainly want a front row seat when they start to run these things.
And a big vision here is we want this to be an opportunity for students to perform a national public service. You can do Teach for America, Peace Corps, join the Army, military. But the vision that we have and Steve shares as well is let's make this an opportunity for public service where our brightest young men and women in top universities across the country can engage in this problem-solving efforts to solve real problems that really matter, that can really make a difference, and use their talents and skills and expertise to really have an impact.
Couldn't leave well enough alone. Hacking for Defense was great. Hacking for Diplomacy went well. So folks from USAID popped up and said, what about Hacking for Development? Folks with commercial issues dropped up and said, everybody who is not Amazon has commerce problems. How about Hacking for Commerce? I've spent lots of time in urban areas around the country, and mine has always been, while the federal government's got some really cool problems, our cities and our states dwarf them in their ability to generate problems. And wouldn't it be a really cool thing if we could take the problems in a city or an area in a state and connect it to the local university and better connect the students in that university to their community?
Yeah, wow. So that reminds me of this incredible opportunity that Pete and I had in the fall to spend the day with the chief of FDNY. And he explained some of the issues facing the fire department of New York City. You know, the last 15 years, of course, we remember 9/11. But then there was Sandy, the hurricane. And then there was the Legionnaires' disease outbreak. And that he heard about this, and he really wants help from the local universities. And there's some great ones there, great engineering schools at NYU and Columbia and so on. So this is a mechanism for students not only to do the public service and to learn these methods, and they may or may not continue with them, but to instead of doing, you know, I don't want to sound frivolous here, but, you know, instead of doing a simulation on something that is not so meaningful, to work on something like this. So it's a win-win for both sides.
So I have to acknowledge Bruce Cahan, who's the Stuckey for helping us write the Hacking for Urban Resilience, which is the cities and the states are trying to get this into. Our goal by 2020 is 100 universities across the country, teaching some version, variant of this class, servicing the problems either from the local level, from the national level, from nonprofits to policy issues, all of that stuff.
So I'm getting the signal here. So we want to say thanks. Let me just wrap up, but in addition to thanks, but first of all, join me in thanking Joe and Pete for telling this story, please.
And Tom and Steve Blank, who made this really happen for
well,
us.
Thank you. So it's a natural fit for what we do in the engineering school. We've had an entrepreneurship center for 20 years, and of course our most important audience is the Stanford students. The matriculating Stanford students, you know, are paying our bills, but no, we're all about the students. But we've always been, in terms of growing that center, about sharing everything we do and dissemination. You know, what makes me really happy about this, what's taken place in 2016, is that last slide of the showing the scaling, the spreading of this to other universities around the country. It really is something else. I just visited North Dakota State University in Fargo, North Dakota, and sat with the provost, and they're incredibly excited about this in that neck of the woods. So this is something that's igniting a movement. And one last thing. Remember, I'm a wrap back around in the beginning. I said, look, when I first got asked to come here, I thought I'd come in and give you a report card. And I tried to do it in 5 minutes, which is innovation and entrepreneurship education is now readily available for every college student. And that's kind of crazy. Well, that was I left out one little thing. The growth of that has created two parallel tracks, one having to do with for-profit situations, and then you might have heard of this term social entrepreneurship. That tends to be a whole nother set of units and activities. So for the first time, I'm most optimistic that this can provide a bridge that has not existed yet. And I'm not talking about it just at Stanford. We make it our business to understand what's going on at every university, not in the United States, not just in the United States, but around the globe. So this makes me really excited about connecting those two movements, that, you know, for-profit entrepreneurship education, but also with social entrepreneurship education. And I'm sure you can see the connection. So let's, do we have a couple minutes, my friend?
Good evening, thank you. So I have two questions that are related to each other. There was a statement made early on that you're not attacking the procurement system, and I'm curious, why not? It seems to me that the present day procurement system is a huge part of the problem. And then looking forward, related to that, what, and speaking specifically about DOD, what is the third offset strategy doing to help institutionalize some of these new approaches?
And please explain third offsite for the two, for us and layman.
Yeah.
So who would take procurement first, and then someone offsite talk about third offsite?
So in my humble opinion, I'll go back to what I said about speed. The third offset isn't about any single technology. It's about how fast you find that problem and get it in the hands of the people who can deliver the technology to solve it. No longer does it matter how good your stuff was when it started. And no longer can you talk about dominating anything with any particular, not in the market, and certainly not on the battlefield. It doesn't count. The people have gotten quick enough that they don't have, they're not going to attack our strength. In fact, you know, one of the biggest difficulties the Department of Defense Intelligence Agency has is as soon as we focus on something, we start to create gaps between other things else. And the world has gotten really good at running our gaps and filling them full of things. And unfortunately, in our drive to become more efficient at doing certain things, we have used up all our resources to have people who fill the gaps very quickly. That's what we're missing. My humble opinion, the third offset is about the speed of delivery of technology. The value of the engagement in Silicon Valley for DOD isn't the technology. It's the way Silicon Valley makes decisions about killing things off to focus on things that work well and get them delivered fairly quickly. That's the real value of the presence of DOD in the Valley. Less about the technology than it is about the mindset of how decisions are made.
In our current system, if you're building an aircraft carrier, submarine, it's
serves
been
around
that,
for 50 years.
It serves that purpose. So it's not replacing the current system. It's adding to it, having other options for cases that aren't like aircraft carriers and submarines. You know, the types of technology that Pete's describing. Yeah.
Or maybe we could take this off. Let's just follow up outside with it to make sure somebody else has a chance. Yeah, thank you, sir.
It sounds to me like a lot of the success that comes from this is because people open their minds to new ideas and new ways of doing things. But this is more a comment. Maybe you might want to add something. The world seems to be going, they don't want to open their minds. They want to close it. They don't want information. And I don't know if you want to comment about how maybe hacking can hacking for new, accepting new ideas, if there is such a thing.
Yeah.
I tell you, if you spend much time on a college campus, they are open-minded. You know, they will.
Sure, but
you got to sprint to keep up with some of their ideas.
The world is actually outside of the college campus. Is actually
going.
Yeah, and this is why we need these courses. Yeah. I mean, that in my view, it makes me optimistic. One more, and then we'll wrap up.
You mentioned the need for a rapid response to a combat situation in a data set that spanned just 2 years. Now, this class approach is fantastic, but you need to take that data and get it to the students rapidly, and I think there'd be a lot of time at which this data was sensitive. So how do you balance the need for removing sensitive data and possibly removing the answer to the need for rapid response from these students?
That's great. In both classes, because one was with defense support and the other one was with state. So how did we do that?
Well, it's problem generation. We make sure we have the types of problems that we'd avoid some of these challenges. And you can work on some, even like the NSA, for example. I'm hoping this is the direction you wanted to go with this. You can work on a problem that may, the solution may have applications to a classified challenge they're dealing with.
We call them analogous problems.
Analogous, exactly.
We have learned over the year through a couple of near misses how to, I'll give you for instance, one of our teams was working counter-adversarial social media targeted ISIS. The near miss was they called their problem sponsor one day and said, hey, can we have the ISIS database on blah, blah, blah? The next phone call was from the FBI.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, in the middle of the night, too.
All right. And so that caused us a 48-hour spin-ex.
Yeah.
But you know what? You know what is exactly what's going on with ISIS and everybody else? In the middle of a political season. The Ptolemy says, just collect the data on the Clinton-Trump campaign. It's the same stuff. Disinformation, fake news, it's identical. It's an analogous environment that you gather data you can talk about, knowing that it has other applications someplace else. So when we do the problem generation, we work very closely with those problem sponsors to actually get it to the point that not only is it unclassified, it is suitable for open university standards, which means we don't tell the foreign national students you can't comply.
Yeah, and there's plenty
open
of
open university standards apply to everything we do.
Well, it was, as you can see, it was such an honor to be involved with these two last year on these prototypes. A lot's changed in the United States and the world over that last year as well. And you know what a backdrop, as you alluded to. So Secretary Carter came out and visited, was a big fan of this. Soon to be former Secretary of Defense Carter. You saw the picture of Secretary Kerry coming to see that prototype. So Jim Mattis, what do you think he's going to think about this?
If it makes our country safer and stronger, he's going to be behind it, and he does.
Because you both know him.
And he, yep. We actually asked him to be the course advisor.
We've been keeping him apprised of it for...
Yeah.
We're kind of hoping he was going to be the advisor for the next course.
So. Yeah, he's going to be a little busy. This is good for our national security. You know, good for our defense, makes us safer. And I think, I know the Secretary of Defense right. And everyone underneath him is going to fall in.
And last word, Pete.
Well, I would say one unabashed advertisement. We start teaching the next Hacking for Defense class at Stanford on the 4th of April.
That's right.
And we teach every Tuesday from 4:30 to 7:30.
Yeah.
You're more than welcome to come join us.
Yeah.
Sit in the room, see for yourself. We for sure will have 8 teams working on problems, and those 8 teams need great advisors.
Yeah,
mentors.
Love to have more advisors.
Tech mentors.
Well, just check out all this on the web and Steve Blank's website and just Hacking for Defense. If you're interested, all those videos you saw, we have the entire set, the 8 teams from defense, 8 teams from diplomacy. Look, you've been very, very nice to us over the last hour, giving us your attention. And once again, thanks to PARC for sponsoring us. So I hope you learned something. I certainly did. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.